What is route selection? There are usually many synthetic pathways or routes to construct a given structure. There is almost always more than one route, and each route will have given starting materials and intermediates, but also a choice of reagents, reaction types, and solvents to construct the product. Sometimes route selection can be relatively simple, as we can see from this molecule here. The choice is fairly straightforward. Essentially four building blocks. All of these building blocks are commercially available at scale. And the key task is really order of connection. And it's a convergent, not linear process. And we can see the four building blocks being highlighted here. And in practice, this is the disconnection. This is how the molecule was made. So reaction one, reaction two, reaction three. But sometimes route selection can be much more challenging. If we look at this molecule, triglycerol, it's altogether more thought-provoking. It has a number of challenging synthons, a highly functionalized cyclopentane ring, a novel heterocyclic core, and an amino cyclopropyl benzene fragment. It also has the complexity of six chiral centers that have to be controlled. And at the start of the project, none of these main synthons were commercially available. So a much more challenging structure. Selecting the optimum route for a given API is often an iterative task. There may be several or many paper routes. These need to be evaluated on paper and the shortlist tested in the lab. This may lead to several rounds of test, evaluate, refine before the best route is chosen. It should always be borne in mind, however, that the route selected reflects the best science and technology available at that point in time, and advances in the development of new catalysts, biocatalysts, synthetic methodology and so, may enable in the future a route discarded or as unfeasible or economic at the time of selection. So what are some of the key criteria we think about when we're selecting the route? So choosing the synthetic route can be a complex task with many important criteria to consider. A key publication, Chemical Reviews, 2006, described the SELECT criteria. So that's safety, environmental, legal, economics, control, and throughput. So we can see some of the subsections here in safety. So thermal reactive hazards, use of toxic materials, environmental impact, the volume and nature of waste. Legal, ensuring intellectual property rights. We don't want to breach anyone's patents. Economics, we've got to meet the cost of goods for the target molecule. Control, we've got to meet the quality specifications. And throughput, so that looks at the availability of more materials, manufacturing time. Can we make enough material to satisfy commercial demand? A route that could make 100 kilos of a product per year may be suitable for a low volume material, but this may not be suitable for 100 tons per year. So if we think about the environmental impact of a process, the biggest impact we can have as chemists is in the R&D, route selection process. Here we can design processes that minimise the use of resources, use recycling, etc., minimise our generation of waste. By the time we get down here to the manufacturing, where the process is established and validated in a manufacturing plant, all we can really do with the waste is render harmless. So the likelihood of success in generating a good environmentally friendly route to an API increases as we move back up this chain here. And as I said, the biggest impact we can have, really, as chemists, is in this point here. Okay, so to get a really good, efficient process, choosing the route is the foundation, really. Most processes can be improved, you know, in terms of efficiency, costs, throughput, but choosing a good route, convergent, low number of steps, few isolations, minimum number of unit operations, makes for easier optimization than a long and inefficient route that has a high number of steps, many isolations, issues in processing. Good route design is the foundation on which to build. So we can use good green chemistry and engineering and optimization, and these can all improve the selected route. But if we have fundamental flaws, these can be very difficult to salvage. What is the best route? Well, a route which offers the best balance between operational, environmental, legal and economic factors at the current state of knowledge. And of course, best is at a given point in time, and this may change in the future. So it's always important to evaluate all costs when designing a route to an API to ensure that the product is produced for an economically attractive price. For this simple molecule shown at the top, the plant, labour and equipment costs tend to dominate the full product costs. If we look at some of the solvent costs and solvent treatment costs, these are relatively small. However, if we consider just the raw materials to make this product, the solvent and disposal costs are now the biggest contributors, as we can see here. So in terms of minimizing the environmental impact of a process, it's vital to think about which solvents we use and reduce the amount of solvent we use. But in some cases, this can also be a major contributor towards the cost of the product. So if we look at the revenue stream of an API product, so here we have time and money. Of course, in the R&D phase, we're spending money to develop the product and launch it onto the market. So it costs us money. This is negative. When we get onto the market, hopefully the product will start to sell and we will make money. And it will eventually go off patent and sales will start to drop. Well, where can a good route help us? Well, it can reduce development costs. It can lower costs to launch. It can give us increased returns once on the market. And designing and introducing better, more economical, more sustainable routes later can generate and defend patent life. So if we look at some examples, project one here, we can't show the structures, but these are real projects. The initial cost of material was around £1.5 million per kilo. This is a considerable amount of money to spend, and thinking here about new and more efficient and cheaper routes could save a considerable amount of money in the development phase. Product two. This had sales volumes at launch of around 30 tonnes. Thinking and designing a good route here saved around $30 million in the first year. And if you ramp up to peak sales, that's up here. This is a high volume product, and the savings in designing a good route were quite considerable. Project number three. This was a compound with a very long multi-step route, and failure to fix that inefficient route would double the company's annual hazardous waste generation. Okay, so here we'll look at some of the positive metrics gained by changing the synthetic route. The data displayed here are from four routes used to make the API lotrifiban shown on the right, and we'll see more of this molecule throughout the rest of the training package. Routes A to D are shown here, and what you can see is the E factors. This is the kilogram of materials used to make 1 kilo of product. And if we look across the four routes, and these four routes were really aligned with the development phases of this compound, we can see dramatic falls in the use of process water, solvents and input materials across the four routes. This has two important consequences. The environmental of the process is dramatically improved, of course, but the cost of the product and the API also falls dramatically as we refine the processes, and they have much better throughput. The impact of good route selection can be vital to the commercial viability of a product. In this case, the route A, which was used at the med chem stage, would be far too costly and result in a product too expensive for the market. In developing better and more cost efficient and low cost routes across B, C and D, we now have a manufacturing cost that's acceptable, and we can sell that product and it can be dosed to patients at an acceptable price.
So apart from the improved environmental metrics, so we're using far less solvent, we're generating far less waste. Through good root selection, we've reduced the cost of this API by around 85%. Okay, root selection, some key strategies just to finish up. We should minimise the number of steps in the synthetic route. 4 will be cheaper and greener than 10 steps. We should look to get convergent and not linear syntheses. We should look to use catalytic reactions, identify risks and remove, minimise the use of hazardous materials. As discussed previously, solvents are a major burden. We should choose and use wisely. Gather and use appropriate metrics. We need to beware of green wash solutions. We should minimise unit operations and energy usage. Avoid isolation and drying if we can. We should think about process intensification, things like flow chemistry. Can we use those to design cleaner and better routes? Consider where we can reuse and recycle. And of course, we'll never effectively remove all of the waste. So we need to think about effective abatement and waste treatment measures. So how do we gather together the information needed to design synthetic routes? Well, there are now quite a wide number of packages available to do this, and there are some listed here. And these are very commonly used by medicinal and process chemists to seek out information on compounds, intermediates, reactions, and really now helping you to design in silico new synthetic routes to APIs of choice.